when we put this topic on agenda, people said, oh, you can't talk about medical marijuana or cannabis. People won't show up, or we lost some sponsors as a result of it. This may be the first time that you've sat in a program like this where this topic has been brought up, but I think it's just a sign of the times. I think it was this week that Coca-Cola announced it's looking at putting CBD oils or something in Coca-Cola, which I guess probably tells you that the times there are changing. But let's see if there's anybody who's brave enough to ask their panelists some questions. Yes, sir. So the question was, are there specific forms of CBD that would be prescribed for medical illnesses? And I guess it starts with, there's no real prescription here. So
there isn't a prescription, but you have different cannabinoid isolates that you can actually extract from the plant. So it's true that, like hemp, you know, you really kind of grow hemp in that sense for the CBD because it's CBD rich. But there's plenty of cannabis strains that are high in CBD. It'd be more or less like you have CBD, you have CBG. Like there's a whole laundry list of acronyms, but if you actually look it up, it'll tell you, you know, you would prefer this, like if you have nausea, okay? You would want to take this if, you know, if it's more for like an anti-inflammatory. Yeah, you could do topical, you could do capsules. There's, syringe form that you take, not that you would actually put in, but it's just a dosing mechanism. But a lot of that is do something that would be ingested, like an edible or something like that. You can, you know, vape it or have it in a, if you're going to have like a joint or something like that, whatever you want to do, it's, you can put it in there, but there's better ways for your body to ingest that. I would personally eat it.
The topical preparations, the active material is mixed in with a cream or an ointment, and then it's absorbed through the skin, and that's how the body distributes it around. And the ingestion obviously goes through, like any other food, it's digested and distributed that way. There are still some folks who advocate smoking. Anytime you inhale the products of combustion into your lungs, you're getting not just the active ingredient that you want, but you're getting hundreds of other chemicals that you don't want. So no one, at least in the medical community, really advocating smoking, although we acknowledge that that's how many people are taking their cannabis currently because they don't have other choices. But staying with ingestion and topical and absorbing through the skin seem to be the best way to ensure that you know what you're getting and you're getting it in controlled amounts and you can predict measure how it affects you.
When I was a caregiver, I had five patients, and two of them had Parkinson's. And the ointment really wasn't, that's fine if you want to do that. I personally would rather ingest it and let your body disperse it that way.
The question is whether or not, if you look across the world, are there, has the testing been done somewhere else that you can look to?
Yes. I think that probably the most progressive country is Israel. They've done a lot of testing with this. It's legal in many of the European Union countries, and they've done some testing. But Israel has done a tremendous amount of testing on this. Anything that you take today, such as patches, sublingual, ointments, creams, capsules, edibles, it can be done, put in any type of product. The key is, there's no regulations. So it's similar to the over-the-counter products where, you know, there's not the regulations that they have on pharmaceutical products, but there's pharmaceutical-grade CBD, and that's the one that most people would be interested in taking, that pharmaceutical-grade.
So the question raised was, what did Canada recently do on cannabis? and it's recreationally legal.
It's legalized throughout the entire country.
I think the law goes into effect in October, isn't it?
But I mean, they're already releasing, like, they're decriminalizing it. So criminals that are now, it's stupid, I'm going to call them criminals because they're not, they're being released. But if they had, like, a marijuana offense, depending on what they were doing, you know, what the offense was for, they're being released currently. People that were on hold for trials related to that, all those have been dropped. So it's been completely decriminalized, and I thought it was pretty cool. They recently came out looking at it as recovery treatments for their soldiers coming back. So, you know, I think when people, like, laugh about that, and I kind of laughed when I heard about it. I was like, well, how are you going to regulate that, like, within a unit, like, medically? You know, someone such as the doctor who sit there that might be able to, you know, recommend therapies like that, I don't suggest that it's available in everyday use, but I think that's pretty interesting because CBD can help you recover, as you just saw correctly.
So let me repeat the question for those who are further back who may not have heard it. And since it's not FDA approved and thereby rated, how do you know where to start and what quality and grade you should be looking at? How do you get that sorted out for yourself, I think, is the question.
And I understand it's kind of like a dying task. It kind of starts with the education part. So if you were thinking about, you know, I want to do this, I would do the research. And I would get on and just look at, like, okay, what are some of the things that I'm looking for? Like, I would, if I had joint pain, I would literally Google joint pain cannabis treatments. And there would be a list of kind of things to ask. And when you go to a dispensary, you're going to want to ask, you know, whoever's there at the counter, you know, say, you know, I'm kind of looking for this, you know, are there any particular suggestions, companies that you would recommend? Right now, my caregiver is a retired chief of an officer.
And there are veterans groups involved in this space. So
absolutely.
If you want to mention a couple of them.
And I won't say, you know, Odin's Outcast is cannabis. You know, they're not tied in with that, but we have a lot of cannabis friendly veterans that are a part of Odin's Outcast.
Many of us in the medical community are, you know, we want to have all of the tools available to us to relieve people's symptoms that we can have. And if it turns out that CBD and cannabis-based products are safe and effective, I want that research done. I want those tools in my toolkit. And I'm concerned that the arguments and the issues around recreational marijuana are going to bleed over into the medical marijuana domain and obscure the real issues or put barriers in place to getting that important work done. So I don't welcome the recreational marijuana conversation because it may distract people from something very helpful that won't happen. Well, there are some states, you know, that have had recreational marijuana for a number of years, Oregon, Washington State, Colorado. The public health departments in those states are very interested in the impact. But it's just too soon to know what the overall public health and public safety impact of recreational marijuana has been. Recreational marijuana are going to bleed over into the medical marijuana domain and obscure the real issues or put barriers in place to getting that important work done. So I don't welcome the recreational marijuana conversation because it may distract people from something very helpful that
I want to thank everybody for participating in this conversation. It's the first time we've had it here at the Veterans Summit. I can tell there's more interest than we have time available, so maybe by next year we'll be able to carve out more time and more will have happened.